do too much. So yesterday we discussed a whole bunch of ADS-CFT stuff and so on, and this morning you saw several applications of that formalism, and I think you'll discuss many more, and transport and so on. So that's great, so I don't have to discuss those. So I'd like to now start discussing a bit the main topic of these lectures. So as I told you, you could get ADS-CFT, you could derive ADS-CFT by starting from brains and taking suitable low energy slash decoupling limits. And then from the brain point of view, you got a field theory, and from the gravitational point of view, you got ADS. You can repeat that story if you start with finite temperature brains. So what I described yesterday was just brains in their ground states, and they were given by some geometry, but you can heat up both sides of this original starting point. From a brain point of view, it means that you put these D brains at a finite temperature. The corresponding gravitational descriptions, they now will also be finite temperature, so they are so-called black brains. And you can take a decoupling limit. So these black brain solutions, their geometries look quite similar to the geometries I wrote down yesterday, except that they have an extra piece in this function h, which was like the warp factor of these metrics. And that extra piece makes these things make sure that these things develop a horizon. So it's not a black hole; it's a black brain. So the horizon is not a sphere. It's a sphere times a couple of non-compact directions. So it's really a horizon that surrounds these non-compact brains. If the D brain was a point, then it would look like a black hole. And if it's a line, it looks like a black string, etc. The details of this are not so important. The upshot is that once you take the decoupling limit, you find, you derive, if you wish, that finite temperature conformal field theories are the same as black holes in ADS. Now, this statement requires a bit of more explanation later, because the only ADS-CFT correspondences that we derive in this way were the ones where the field theory was living on a plane, on Minkowski spacetime, and we also found ADS where the boundary was a plane. You cannot directly, in most cases, derive this statement when the boundary is a cylinder rather than a plane by taking this limit. So if the boundary is a cylinder, then finite temperature CFT is not always the same as a black hole in ADS, but I'll come back to that a bit later. For now, this is good enough. So the simplest thing that you can find, I'm just going to write down an explicit example. So I'm just going to write ADS3. So this was the metric of ADS3. It's a bit easier for some computations to use lower ADSs. So this is the metric of ADS3 without any temperature or any black hole or anything in it. Now, if you go through this exercise for ADS3, what happens is you get something like this. That's it. So that's this is called the BTZ black hole. Bagnados, Teitelbaum, Zanelli black hole. And that's it's a funny thing that because in three dimensions, there is no propagating graviton in three dimensions. The gravity in three dimensions is boring. A graviton has no propagating degree stream, so it's almost like a topological theory. And it's peculiar that although you don't have propagating gravitons, you still can write down a black hole solution. It's a bit different. Like, if you want to write down a three-dimensional black hole in flat space, it's kind of complicated because you have to destroy the asymptotics. But in ADS, it's fine. And although you don't have propagating gravitons, in principle, there can be matter fields and so on that interact with the black hole. So all the puzzles and all the annoying things, like the information paradox, they can all be formulated already in ADS3, although gravity, strictly speaking, is not even dynamical. Now, we can learn a bit more about the thermodynamics of these black holes and check that it agrees with a conformal field theory computation. So let's slowly do that in some detail. So we first want to write down the entropy of this black hole. Now, as you can see, the Schwarzschild radius is when r is equal to square root of m, because then these factors are zero. This phi is an angular coordinate, so it has size 2 pi. So the horizon here is not a sphere, it's a circle, because we're in three dimensions. The length of that circle is given by 2 pi times the radius, and the radius of a square root of m. And then by the famous Bekenstein-Hawking formula, area divided by 4g, the entropy of this black hole is given by this combination here. As an exercise for the exercise for later, is if you have the following metric, and FRH is equal to GRH equals zero. So suppose you have a general metric that looks a bit like that, with a function f and a function g that vanish at some particular value of RH. And I'll leave this a little exercise to show that the Hawking temperature of this thing is the square root of f prime at RH. So you have to assume that these derivatives are non-zero. It's the square root of f prime RH, g prime RH divided by 4 pi. And the way you have to do this exercise is by making time imaginary and then seeing for which periodicity of imaginary time this is a regular geometry. That is an easy way to get a Hawking temperature. You might want to convince yourself that this is really the temperature, blah, blah, but I'm not going to go, that's kind of standard textbook material. It is just convenient to have this little equation here. So the temperature of this black hole is given by this equation, but in the exercise session, you can check it for yourself. If we plug it in for this guy, this is what comes out. If I apply that formula to what's written here, because f prime, f and g are the same, and the derivative of f and g is 2r, so this is 2 times rh times 2 times rh, and the 2 cancels a 2 in the 4, and then what's left is the rh, which was square root of m. Good. Now, dE equals TdS. As usual in thermodynamics. So we can now check what E is. Two pi, let me see that I miss a factor of two somewhere, because clearly this is not quite correct. I have screwed up a factor of two somewhere in my notes, I think. I'll figure it out later. Let's keep this for the time being. Because this should be eight if you take this the way it's written, but I made a mistake in my notes, but we'll figure it out. So this is how you get the energy. So you can see that what is called M here indeed is something like the energy or the mass of the black hole. Yeah, so this is this factor of 2, right? This should be 8 if I do it like this. I'll just put 8 here. Now, so this is just what comes out of this black hole. And a standard check of AGCFT is to see whether we can reproduce all of this from the dual CFT. Now, in general, it's very hard because we have some unknown conformal field theory living on the boundary. And in general, if you have some strongly coupled theory on the boundary, you would think that the entropy of the theory on the boundary depends on all the matter fields that you have, and it depends on all the details of the theory. But two-dimensional conformal field theories are special. Two-dimensional conformal field theories are special for the following reason. So suppose that we assume that the temperature is large. Then from a two-dimensional conformal field theory, how do you compute the partition function of the two-dimensional conformal field theory? Well, this conformal field theory lives on a circle with radius 2 pi. But then you need to compactify it on another circle whose radius is the inverse temperature. That is the Euclidean partition function for at finite temperature. The periodicity in imaginary time is the inverse of the temperature. So this is a very small circle because T is large. Very often, if you think about standard CFT notation, we would probably write it like this because this thing is a 2 torus. You periodically identify time in this direction and space in this direction, and this is 2 pi, that's the inverse temperature. And that's the partition function that you need to compute on a torus with these two sides. Now we can use the fact that it's democratic. You can choose what you call time and what you call space. It's Euclidean computation. And we can also use the fact that the theory is scale invariant. So in particular, we can multiply both sides by t. And then we can multiply by another 2 pi. And then we can just flip it because it's Euclidean torus, so it doesn't matter what you call time and space. So this is just a cartoon picture of what is known as modular invariance of a two-dimensional conformal field theory. But it simply follows by using scale invariance of the theory and starting from this original computation here and doing a few rescalings. So you see that the partition function of a two-dimensional conformal field theory at temperature T is the same as the partition function of the same conformal field theory on the same circle, but now at a temperature 1 over 4 pi squared T. So it's a duality between high and low temperature. If you're interested in the regime where T is large, then this will be in this case, the temperature will be low. That means that if this is a very low temperature system, that we will basically be in the ground state. At high temperature, you're at very excited states, right? But at low temperature, you'll be in the ground state mostly, because beta is very large, so all higher energies are very much suppressed, so only the first term here is important. So the partition function here will be equal to minus the ground state energy times 4 pi squared t. Because beta was the inverse temperature, which is just given by this length here, right? So that's why the tea is upstairs now, not downstairs, because we went from high to low temperature. So this is the partition function that you get. Now, if you have the partition function, let me rewrite this partition function. Let's also assume that E naught is negative, otherwise this result doesn't make too much sense. We'll see in a moment what E naught is supposed to be. So if this is a good estimate for the partition function of the high temperature conformal field theory, then from that Z, you can simply, using standard thermodynamical relations, find out what the entropy is at a given energy. And you find, using standard thermodynamic relations, and you also find that the relation between the inverse temperature and energy is 2 pi square root E naught divided by E. Beta is large. Yeah, because if we do this computation, we need to know the details of all the high energy states. That depends a priori on the details of the theory. However, if we can map this high temperature computation to a low temperature computation, now it only depends on the energy of the ground state. And that's a much more robust feature than the expected high energy spectrum. So this is one of the, you know, miracles of two-dimensional conformal field theory, if you want. So these are some standard expressions for any two-dimensional conformal field theory in the high temperature limit. This relation here is also known as the Cardy formula in two-dimensional conformal field theories, because it tells you that there is a uniform behavior for the entropy as a function of energy at high energy. It doesn't depend on the details of the theory. The only dependence is through this thing called E naught here. And E naught, for those who know more about 2D CFT, E naught is proportional to the central charge of the theory. So it's a very simple universal quantity. Now, in this particular background, we can also try to see what this E naught is supposed to be. Because we want E naught, we want to be the ground state energy. The ground state of this theory is global ADS. This is just empty ADS. But now you have to be a bit careful, because if M is equal to zero, you might think that that is the ground state of the theory, but that's not quite true, because this phi here was a periodic coordinate. So we really want to have global ADS here, where the boundary is a cylinder, and not this Poincaré ADS, which you would have if this was just a linear coordinate. And if M is zero, and you go all the way to R equals zero, then this circle shrinks, and it's a singularity still. There's like a little weird isolated singularity sitting there. It's kind of a peculiar solution. It's called the M equals zero BTZ black hole. It's not really a black hole, but it's also not a fully regular solution. It's a particular limit. And clearly, we need some other physics to understand what's going on when M is equal to zero, because there's like this little singularity sitting in the middle. So M equals zero is not the ground state of the theory. In fact, you can... we need to remember a little bit how we wrote global ADS. This was one set of variables that we saw yesterday that described global ADS in these funny variables. Now we want it to look a bit more like that geometry over here. So we're going to call U is sinh R. So U will be like that radius, because if we do this, you get U squared d phi squared, and it will be very similar to what's written here. So U is sine hyperbolic R. Well, then you just need to massage this metric a little bit, and you need to do a change of variable. That is completely straightforward. And what you get is minus u squared plus 1 dt squared plus du squared divided by 1 plus u squared dy squared. It's just a change of variable. So you see that it's precisely that geometry, but with m is equals to minus 1. So you have to sort of, this is a very weird, peculiar feature of black holes in AGS3, is you have this very simple black hole, but you need to make m negative in order to find the ground state of the theory. And for any negative, you can also look take negative values between minus 1 and 0, and then, again, you will find that this is not a regular metric. It has a mild singularity when m is between minus 1 and 0. That mild singularity is a conical singularity. That is considered to be a mild singularity. It's still a singularity, though. So this would suggest that the ground state energy, I should have written this here, because it was negative, that the ground state energy is minus 1 over 4g, ag, sorry. Now, we have a complete set of dictionary. We have a ground state energy, we have an energy, we have a temperature and an entropy. We know the relation between m and e and everything. And now if you compare these equations to S and T and E naught that you get here, then you will find, except maybe for the factor of 2 that I screwed up somewhere, you'll find that everything is in perfect agreement with each other. Yes? Between minus 1 and 0, yes. Yeah. It's locally constant, right? Yeah, locally.
So the singularity is not really a curvature singularity?
No, it is a proper curvature singularity. So you could argue that at that point, you don't really solve the field equations. Because but that's typical of singularities, is that at the singularity, you don't really solve the field equations. That's why any solution with a singularity is an incomplete description of the actual physics. Because you need to explain what happens at the singularity, and you're not, so some quantum physics or matter fields need to come in, and they need to resolve this conical defect somehow. Yeah. Yeah, these equations make no sense once m goes below zero. That is because you're not in a thermodynamic regime. You don't have a finite horizon. So what the usual words that we say about entropy and black hole, that doesn't apply to singularities without horizons. So these equations are not to be taken serious when m is negative. The only thing that I extrapolated was the relation between E and m, because that energy makes sense also for negative m. Sorry? No, it has a positive central charge. Yeah, it's minus, sorry, it's E naught is also known as the Casimir energy or something like that. So it's minus C over 12, something like that, yeah, in terms of the central charge. No, the central charge is positive, Casimir energy is negative. Now, this is, it's quite nice that here you can check. This is one of the few cases where you can explicitly check that gravitational computations agree on the nose with field theory computations. You can even look at slightly more complicated BTC black holes, namely rotating BTC black holes. For that, you have to introduce rotation in the geometry. And you still get perfect agreement with these entropy formulas from 2D CFT, these things called the Cardy formula. So that's quite nice. It's one of the more interesting maybe tests of ADS-CFT that you get this perfect agreement between black hole entropy and some universal answer in a 2D CFT. Now, in other cases and in other dimensions, this might not work, because this trick, this universal growth of the density of states in a 2D CFT, is a very special feature of two dimensions. You will find a large number of papers that roughly proceed by looking at some geometry, finding something that looks like a two-dimensional conformal field theory structure. You have these entropy formulas, then you take these entropy formulas and you just use this to compute the entropy. For example, there's proposals to compute the entropy of a Kerr black hole in four dimensions in this way, by identifying some suitable Virasoro algebra somewhere and claiming there's a 2D CFT, etc. But many of these things are suspicious at best, because this really computation is only correct if you have a proper unitary modular invariant two-dimensional conformal field theory. And if the only thing that you have is a Virasoro algebra, that does not imply this. If you have a Virasoro algebra, it has a perfectly fine unitary representation which consists just of that associated to a single primary field. That's a perfectly okay Hilbert space. If you compute a partition function over that Hilbert space, it's not modular invariant. Modular invariance tells you need many other fields as well. So you need more than just having some Virasoro algebra floating around somewhere to claim that you have an explanation of the black hole entropy. There are other things that where you go do some near-horizon physics for general black holes, and you also find some approximate two-dimensional conformal symmetry, and then you immediately plug it into these equations and claim you have computed the Schwarzschild black hole entropy. Those are equally suspicious, because you really need to have a unitary, well-behaved, modular invariant 2D CFT to have all these things work. So this is a very nice test of ADS-CFT, where you really can compare a CFT computation to a Bell computation. And the great thing is that, obviously, that this doesn't really depend on a coupling constant, it just depends on some energy. So whether you're at weak or strong coupling, it doesn't really matter. As long as you know the ground state energy or the central charge of the theory, then you're good. And the central charge of a 2D CFT does not depend on coupling constants, so it's the same at weak and at strong coupling. And that's why all these equations are reliable and can be reliably extrapolated from weak to strong coupling. But that's special. In higher dimensions, briefly, you can repeat all these steps. So here's a higher dimensional ADS black hole. With some sphere. And now this F of R looks like R squared plus 1 minus alpha, which is some number, R to the D minus 2. So if you don't have this number, just as I just erased, but if you don't have this number, this is just global ADS in those same variables. But once you turn on the temperature, you add this little piece here, exactly like the sort of thing that you know from the Schwarzschild black hole, where you also get such pieces in the metric. And you can check explicitly that this is still a solution of the Einstein equations with a negative cosmological constant. So you don't need a source on the right-hand side. Just like the Schwarzschild solution is a solution of the vacuum Einstein equations, this is also a solution of the negative cosmological constant Einstein equations. Now you can repeat exactly the same things that I wrote before. So for example, the horizon is where this vanishes. That's in general annoying higher order polynomial equations, so that need not have an explicit solution, but who cares? let's just say it has a horizon at RH, we can still compute, for example, the Hawking temperature by that little formula. And you can just plug it in and you get some expression in terms of RH. It's just explicit. Similarly, we can compute the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy of this thing. That's given by the area divided by 4G. So it's the volume of that unit sphere. Whatever that volume is, it's just an annoying function of D, the volume of a unit sphere, times RH, the size of that sphere, times the power D minus 1. And the whole thing is divided by 4 times the Newton constant. Yes? Yeah, good. So in principle, you could have more than one, but there's an sort of an obvious solution that disappears. Well, yeah, there can be more complicated black holes that have more than one solution, and then you have an inner and an outer horizon and those types of structures. I think we only trust and believe these equations if you apply it to the outer horizon. And if you apply it to the inner horizon, you can substitute equations like this, but it's not clear whether they mean anything. Moreover, generically, inner horizons are believed to be very unstable, so they shouldn't be taken seriously as a thermodynamic anything. Yeah. Nevertheless, it sometimes is amusing to apply these equations to inner horizons, and then you sometimes find funny relations between the entropy associated to the outer horizon and the inner horizon. I vaguely remember there's some weird product formula that was it the entropy of the outer horizon times the entropy of the inner horizon has some nice universal form for reasons that no one understands. So, but anyway, inner horizons are not believed to be physically too meaningful. Good. And now you can do, so I'll also leave that as an exercise, it's just some algebra, is to find from dE equals TdS to find what E is. And although you don't know the explicit solutions of this equation, you can just compute what T is, you can compute what S is, and then with a little bit of algebra, you can find out that E is proportional to this alpha. So without actually doing much work, and without actually thinking very hard about the meaning of alpha, we see that alpha is really related to the energy. It's linear in the energy, regardless of the fact that this RH dependence is kind of annoying. It better be proportional to the energy, because we can also think of this alpha over RD minus 2 as some perturbation on top of this background. And if you think of it as a perturbation, it's a perturbation in the metric. And delta G, metric perturbations in an ADS background, if you go towards the boundary, they look like the boundary stress tensor times R minus D plus the boundary metric. So this is the non-normalizable mode, this is the normalizable mode, not normalizable. So if you think as this piece as some metric perturbation, and you see what that metric perturbation does if you go all the way to the boundary, and you use the fact that you can read off the boundary stress tensor from this metric perturbation, then you also find that, and clearly T00 is energy as seen by the boundary theory. You also find that the energy has to be linear in alpha, because that is precisely what this coefficient is doing when you go to R equals infinity. So it's all a self-consistent story. Now, in this case, this entropy, we don't know how to compute it in the field theory directly, because this is no longer in a higher dimensional conformal field theory, entropy is not universal. What you can do in cases, if you have an explicit conformal field theory, you can try to compute the entropy at weak coupling, not at strong coupling, and then compare the weakly coupled field theory answer to this prediction for what the answer for the strongly coupled theory should be. Because ADS describes a strongly coupled field theory. We cannot do computations in a strongly coupled field theory. We can do computations in a weakly coupled theory. So then, but then you're comparing two different numbers. You're comparing a weakly coupled field theory computation to a strongly coupled field theory computation. In general, these answers will be different. If, for example, you do this computation in for n equals 4 super Young mills, and you look at the free energy of that theory, you will find that there is a factor of 3/4 difference between the free energy computed at weak coupling and the free energy computed at strong coupling. It's not a huge number, 3/4, but there's still an annoying factor of 3/4 difference. So that's not really testing ADS-CFT in some sense. It tells you that it's not inconsistent with anything that we know, but it's also not a proof of anything. Yes? Oh, that's a much more subtle, this is a much more down-to-earth effect than that. That's not, it's not related to any such a subtle computation. It simply is the statement that there was no reason for a weakly and a strongly coupled theory to have the same free energy. So we simply do not, there's no reason to believe things to be equal anyway. No. Yeah, it's really that simple. So that's a nice set of black holes, but yeah, not a great test. So for the rest, in principle, you could try to test this more precisely if you would take, say, n equals 4 super Young mills theory and you would put it on a computer, because then you can try to numerically compute the entropy of the system at strong coupling by numerical methods rather than analytic methods that you could try to do. And then you can try to test ADS-CFT a bit better. This has been done in some cases, and in all known cases, the numerics agree within the error margin with whatever the ADS prediction is. There is a really interesting class of black holes, though, for which you can meaningfully compare things. And I will just say that in words, because that's an entire story in itself. Those are so-called BPS black holes. Those are black holes that preserve some supersymmetry. And if you have a black hole that preserves some supersymmetry, then you're in a situation where you have much more control over entropy than you have in the non-supersymmetric case. And the main idea is as follows. In a typical supersymmetric theory, a typical commutator, rather anti-commutator, because these are supercharges, will look something like this. It will look like energy minus some, say, U1 quantum number. That's in a large number of extended supersymmetry algebras, this is the structure that you see. Now, if you want to have a state that is annihilated by Q, by simply in computing the norm of this thing, squared, that means that the energy of that state is the same as the U1 charge of that state. If you have such a relation, that means that now the U1 charge is a discrete number. Charges are quantized, so these numbers are quantized. And because these numbers are quantized, the energy is also quantized, and if the energy is quantized, it cannot depend on the coupling constant, because if you have something that depends on the coupling constant, it would have to vary continuously with the coupling constant, but this forbids that. That means that the states that have this property at weak coupling must also have this property at strong coupling, unless there is some phase transition in the middle. And that means that you can simply count these states at weak coupling, and then you can extrapolate the answer to strong coupling and compare to some gravitational computation. And that has been done in many cases. Those are very nice computations. You can even include higher order corrections to gravity in it and find corrections to black hole entropy and so on. And in this way, there's many checks where you can find that CFT computation equals gravity computation. But it only works because we have basically a non-renormalization theorem, which tells us that these energies are protected. This discussion has a large number of footnotes. One footnote is that it can happen that if you have more than one of these energies, they can sometimes still combine and things can get lifted and so on. And then that's why you really need to compute an index rather than the total number of states. And so on. But it's still, that is not really so important because this is the most important qualitative message, is that you can check things in many different ways. You can do, but it's also remarkable that you can do things more precisely because you can include corrections. By the way, normally, this entropy of a black hole, it is just some continuous function, because it's a black hole at finite temperature, it's thermodynamics, it's something that varies continuously with the temperature. It's an estimate for the number of states associated to the black hole, but that's it. Here, entropy is actually an integer. The number of states is an integer, so the entropy is the log of an integer. Because you can just count the number of states that have exactly this property, and it's an integer. So you get a funny prediction, namely that if you do some gravitational computation and you include lots of corrections, the result should be an integer for these BPS black holes. And that's very that's a very peculiar thing, because you now rewrite something that is an integer as many things that are not integers, but that somehow conspire to form an integer at the end of the day. And in some examples, this could all be computed, including non-perturbative corrections. And you can then prove using number theory that this incredibly complicated series on the right-hand side does in fact resum to an integer. But it's more like a miracle than anything else if you look at those equations that this comes out. Higher order gravities, r squared, r cubed, and so on. Yeah. In principle, you don't even explicitly know all of those. But in these cases, you can argue that most of those don't contribute, and the ones that do contribute, you also happen to know. So that's it's just a combination of miracles that need to happen for this to work out, okay? Sorry, I couldn't quite hear your question. Well, in principle, the number of BPS states, strictly speaking, can change as you go from weak to strong coupling, but it can only appear in a very special way. That's why, technically, the thing that you need to compute is not the total number of states, but you need to compute the index. It's a generalization of what's known as the Witten index that you need to compute, and that's the thing that is really that cannot change along the way. That's really the computation that you need to do. Very good. So here's this black hole. Another important point to point out is that this is global ADS. And the claim was that if you put the system at a finite temperature, it's described by this black hole. However, that's not always the right answer. Because if it turns out that if the temperature is low, you can also describe the system not in terms of a black hole, but the best description is just of in terms of a finite temperature gas in ADS. So the intuition is roughly that if you start at zero temperature, there's nothing in ADS. And ADS is like a box. If you have an actual box and you heat up the box slightly, then the gas in the box will just heat up. And there's nothing wrong with having a finite temperature gas sitting in ADS. It's just a gas of particles. As you increase the temperature more and more, this gas gets hotter and hotter and hotter. And at some point, the density in the gas becomes large enough that the gas can collapse to make a black hole. And at that moment, once that happens, the best description is in terms of a black hole. So there is, in a more detailed description of the system, what you have, and this is only relevant if the boundary is a sphere, because if the boundary is a plane, you don't have this phase. You are always here, but if the boundary is a sphere, then we have the distinction between these two things. Can you? Sorry, it's so much noise here. Yeah. That's right. Yeah, you could think of it, so the question was whether at higher temperatures you can think of it in terms of having like a stable branch and an unstable branch. Yeah, in principle, both things exist at all temperatures. It's just that for low enough temperature, one of the two dominates, and at higher temperatures, the other dominates. But you can write them both down at any temperature in principle. Yeah, that's. I'll comment on that in a second. So let's first describe briefly what happens in the gravitational side of the discussion, and then we can see what it means in the CFT side. Some heuristic estimate that you can make. Is, so if we have a system like this, and you ask how much entropy is there as a function of the energy in the gas and in the black hole, so now we need to estimate that a little bit. So suppose we have a gas in a box and we heat it up. For ADS, the relevant length scale is the so-called ADS curvature radius, because that sets the size of ADS, essentially. So it's like a gas in a box of radius R, ADS. And it's a standard question. If I have a box with gas in it, how much entropy is there in a free gas in a box? You can look it up in your StatMac textbook. You just have to generalize it to arbitrary dimensions. If you look in your StatMac textbook how much entropy you have in a gas in a box with radius R, you find that S is equal to RE. Let me get D divided by D plus 1. So this is how much gas you have, how much entropy you have in the gas in the box. For the black hole, you could in principle stare a little bit at the at these equations. But suppose that we have a large black hole, so that is one can be neglected. Then you see that the Schwarzschild radius here involves a particular fractional power of the alpha that you can plug in here. And you combine everything. And then what you get is that for the black hole, the end, if you work it out, it goes like E times the Planck scale to the power d minus 1 over d minus 2. So this is the roughly the behavior of the entropy of a black hole in d dimensions in terms of the Planck scale and the energy, and this is that of a free gas. Now you can see that because R, that's the size of ADS, is much larger than the Planck scale. Yeah, I might remind you that the Planck scale is simply fixed by the Newton constant. So this Planck scale is super small, but this radius is large. Now if you just compare these two behaviors, you can see that at low energies, so this has a larger power than this. This power is less than one, this power is slightly above one. So at low energies, because this R is so much larger than LP, this function will be larger than this function. But at some value of E, this starts to become larger, because for a very, very, very large E, because this power is larger than that power, this will start to win. And if you want, you can compute roughly where the crossover between the two is by just putting these things roughly equal to each other. And then you get an estimate for the place where the thermal gas and the black hole roughly have the same entropy. And you, that's just, it's, you know, a crude estimate. And that's roughly the transition point between the gas in ADS and the black hole in ADS. Well, you just compute the Schwarzschild radius from this thing here, and you plug it in here, and then you, that's just an estimate, and use the relation for the energy between energy and alpha, etc. So that's roughly how it comes about. So roughly, you can see that that this is giving you a Schwarzschild radius, which is like energy to the 1 over d minus 2. That kind of explains the d minus 2. You have to keep track of the Newton constants, and so that's roughly where it all comes from. Yeah. Then it looks like a D, but I'm sure this answer is correct. That would just, that is D minus, well, even if it were D minus 1 over D, I think this is the right answer, but even if it were D minus 1 over D, it would still be a larger power than this one, and you would still be fine with the argument. Just the transition point would be slightly different, yeah. It may be that this is flat space, kind of a flat space approximation, and that if you do it in ADS for a very large black hole, that this really becomes D minus 1 over D, but it's still the same argument applies that this power is larger than that power. Yep, that's correct. An alternative way to think about this transition is that suppose that we do a Euclidean computation. So the boundary in Euclidean signature of this is a circle, because at finite we're at finite temperature, so Euclidean time is periodic, times a sphere. So this is the boundary, the conformal boundary of this ADS space. It's this sphere times a circle with a finite radius. And we're looking for solutions of the field equations that have this boundary. Now, there are two kinds of solutions then you can write down. You can write down one solution where the S1 smoothly shrinks as you go in ADS, times SD minus 1. But there is another solution that you can write down in Euclidean signature, which is the one where the SD minus 1 shrinks smoothly times the S1. So this, you should think of this really not as a circle, but as a higher dimensional sphere. But you can smoothly shrink a circle to a tip. This is what we call the Segard geometry, maybe for obvious reasons. This is a bit like that, except now the boundary is a higher dimensional sphere and it smoothly shrinks to a point. Geometrically, this is just like global ADS, because in the way I originally wrote global ADS here, there was precisely a sphere shrinking. So this corresponds to the thermal case, the thermal gas case, and this case corresponds to the black hole. Because if you have a black hole with a horizon, it's always true that the Euclidean thermal circle smoothly shrinks as you approach the horizon. So this is the black hole case, and this is the gas case. And what you can do is compute the free energies of this. You compute the gravitational action for both, and you compare which one is larger, and then again you find the transition between the two depending on the temperature. So this is called the Hawking-Page transition for black holes. And it has a simple, relatively simple interpretation. So if you have SUN n equals 4 Supiang-Mills theory, for example, this has, yeah? Yeah, this was an energy argument. So this is, if you want, a microcanonical version of the argument, because I use the energy rather than the temperature. So that's also why if you actually do this computation, you find a transition point that's a bit different from this one. Because this is the canonical computation at fixed temperature, and this is a microcanonical computation at fixed energy. And it turns out this transition happens earlier than this one. But that's just the difference between the microcanonical and the canonical description. These two phases for n equals 4 Supiang-Mills, they have to do with a confinement-deconfinement type of transition. Because if you're in this low energy phase and you compute the entropy, it does not scale with that n. It's order 1. And if you compute the entropy in this higher temperature black hole case, it's of the order n squared. So the scaling goes with n squared here and with 1 here. And the heuristic picture is that, in principle, it's some theory that it's a gauge theory, so you don't have things that are charged under the gauge group. But as in usual QCD, here all the quarks are confined. The only thing that you see is color singlets. That's why you don't see any explicit n. You just see some gauge invariant operators here, but they don't scale with n. Trace f squared is just one operator for any n. There's not n squared, different trace f squared. There's only one trace f squared. So here, all the operators that you write down, they don't have any n dependence. The fact that here the entropy scales like n squared looks like you, instead of having just trace f squared, it's not true, but it looks like you actually see Fija, all the individual n squared components of f. And morally speaking, if you talk about a confinement-deconfinement phase transition, this is exactly what you think that should happen. Here you don't see explicit color indices. You don't see any n color index. But if you're allowed to break up things and deconfine things, then you are supposed to see these color indices. And then the number of these things is n squared, n times n. That's a very heuristic picture, but that's roughly the language we would be using in the gauge theory to describe this behavior. And you can do other tests to see that the physics is very similar to what you think should happen for a confinement, deconfinement phase transition. You can look at expectation values of Wilson loops, for those who know what it is, and see that the behavior of Wilson loops agree with all these transitions, et cetera, et cetera. Sorry? Yeah, so it's an analog of that transition. And the main reason to call it that is because you have O1 and O n squared, but for the rest, it's just a conformal field theory all the way through. There just is a very qualitative behavior in the way the partition function behaves at low and high temperatures. And again, if you look at Wilson loops and so on, they seem to show the same behavior as you would have expected in an actual confining-deconfining theory. So there is a large, there's a substantial qualitative similarity with the confinement-deconfinement transition, but it's not exactly the same. You will probably talk, are you talking about the quark gluon plasma and so as well, or? Oh, Carlos Hoyos, yeah, I was just thinking, I thought you were just, excellent. So in the last two lectures, I wanted to say a bit more about chaos and scrambling and information loss and so on, but I need a bit more preparation for that, which I will do the remainder of this lecture. So this was some black hole in ADS background material. So we need a few pieces from quantum information theory. This will be slightly quick-ish. The main thing, the main player that we very often have here is that we have a system where the Hilbert space can be written as the tensor factor of two other Hilbert spaces, HA tensor HB. Given a state on H, we can always we can do something which is called take the partial trace, and from any state in H, we can construct density matrices on A and B by something called the partial trace. What these reduced density matrices do is the following. So they have the property that trace rho A times any operator in the system A is the same as the expectation value of that operator A times the unit operator in B on the state in the full system. And you can work out in detail how to take this trace. It's literally a trace in the B system because there's this identity sitting here which sort of makes a trace in the B system. But physically what you want is you want to find, given a state in a larger system, you want to find a state that describes the subsystem in such a way that any computation that you do in the subsystem agrees with the corresponding computation in the full system if you do nothing in the rest. So this is the definition of this reduced, so-called reduced density matrix. And if, for example, if the state psi does not have any entanglement, then this is, you just throw away the B piece and you don't do anything. But for example, if the state psi is entangled, and it looks like something like this, if this is the state psi and you use this definition and you demand that this holds for any operator O, you can see that if you start with this entangled state, you get a mixed state for rho A. Now, one thing that we would like to have when we have entanglement is to have some sort of quantitative measure for how much entanglement quantum systems have. And the idea is that if you start with a state psi that does not have entanglement, then this simply becomes a pure state. But if this thing has entanglement, this becomes a mixed state. So the idea is that you compute what's called the entanglement entropy of the system. And it's given by this expression. So this is if rho is a finite temperature state. This is the usual definition of entropy. This is literally what we call entropy. But in this case, we use it slightly differently. In this case, by computing this quantity, we get a quantitative measure for the amount of entanglement that there was between the A and the B system. And therefore, it's called the entanglement entropy. It's entropy, as you can see, it's literally entropy. But it is a way to quantify how much entanglement there is between an A and a B system. And this is a nice quantity. You can write down an axiomatic, a list of axioms that you would like anything that you would that you could call a measure of entanglement to satisfy. This is not the only one that satisfies all those axioms, but certainly it's the simplest one. Satisfies all those axioms. And it satisfies all kinds of interesting inequalities. But I don't really need all of those, so I won't say too much about it. Any questions about this, by the way? Because this is it's useful to know precisely what this means, not just vaguely. Yeah, it has to be non-negative, and it has to be monotonic under, well, there's different types of definitions, but one definition is, for example, it has to be monotonic under positive, completely positive trace-preserving operations, CPTPs, or something like that. There's a slightly different version where you demand it to be monotonic under LOCCs, local operations and classical communications, but it satisfies both those things. Those are the main main ingredients for this. It's always some monotonic behavior. All these monotonic behaviors boil down to the fact that if you do something to the system or erase something, that the thing gets smaller. Yeah. Yeah, there is something like that as well, some concavity property for. Although, I think that's how you show that it behaves in the right way under these operations, because this is a convex function, so, or concave, depending on the choice of minus sign and conventions. But anyway, it's a convex that's used in order to prove that it's monotonic under some of these operations. So, it's an important aspect of this function. And you can prove that if it were not a convex function, it would never meet all the other axioms anyway. So I don't know whether it needs to be a separate axiom or not. Now, in practice, this is a very annoying thing to compute because of the logarithm here that you have to compute of the density matrix. So one way you can try to compute this is by defining some other quantity, namely 1 over 1 minus n log trace rho a to the n. This is called a so-called Rennie entropy. Because now this does not contain the log anymore. It just contains a label n. So you just need to compute powers of row A. The idea to connect these two together is that if you compute this and you take the n to one limit, you recover that result. Well, is your question whether there is a general proof that if you compute this? Yeah, good. So what happens in practice, the idea is that you compute this for integer n, because then you have a finite power of rho. So you compute it for integer n. But here we want to take an n to one limit so that you cannot do if n is an integer. So the next thing that you need to do is to try to find an analytic continuation in N. Such an analytic continuation, first of all, it might be very hard to find. So you can maybe compute this for some N. And if it's a polynomial in N or some other simple function of N, then there is usually a manifest analytic continuation looking at you. But in general, there might be hard to find an explicit analytic continuation. If this N is sitting in as an index in a sum, for example, then it's very hard to analytically continue that. Then you need to do some mathematical trickery. So it might be hard to find the analytic continuation. But if you can find the analytic continuation, you then might worry whether it's the unique analytic continuation, because if you only give me a value of an analytic function at 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 and so on, there is not a unique analytic function. But there is a unique analytic function that does not blow up too fast if you go away along the imaginary axis in N. That is something known as Carlson's theorem. So if you have a good reason to believe that it should not blow up too fast as you go in imaginary n directions, and you can see what that bound must be, because a very simple function, for example, that's analytic, that you can for free add is the sine of pi z, because this function vanishes for all for 2 and 3 and 4, right? So if you find any analytic continuation, you could always for free add this function to it. However, if you go in imaginary directions, this thing blows up exponentially with z. And if you forbid that growth, so the Carlson's theorem says that if you grow exponentially slower than how this grows, then there's a unique analytic continuation. That basically kills off this ambiguity. Well, you then still need to have some physics reason to believe that the thing that you want does not grow like this. That's in most cases probably okay, but you know, it's always a few loose ends here and there. But once you find an analytic continuation and life is good and so on, then you can take this limit and compute this. No. It's nicer to compute, but it doesn't have these nice monotonicity properties that entanglement and so have, right? Now, one thing that we would like to compute sometimes is this quantity in a quantum field theory. So in the quantum field theory, we can try to, the first thing that we need to do if you want to define something like this in a quantum field theory is to decompose the Hilbert space of your quantum field theory in some A and B piece. So one way you can do that, you might try to do it in a different way, is to take some region. Since quantum field theories are local, you can think about all the degrees of freedom in this region. and call this HA. And all the degrees of freedom outside the region you call HB. So that's the rest. That's all the things that are not in A. That's the simplest way to define a sort of an entanglement structure in a quantum field theory. Degrees of freedom in the region times degrees of freedom on the outside. This, however, is an infinite quantity. And one way to think about this infinite quantity is to take a lattice version of the field theory. So suppose we discretize the field theory. So we take some lattice points, and we have some interactions between those points, some nearest neighbor interactions, blah, blah, blah. And now you take some region in this discretized theory. Now, the degrees of freedom are very well separated. There's four, you know, harmonic oscillators or qubits or whatever in this region, and the rest is sitting on the outside. So if we discretize the system, we can very cleanly separate what's inside from outside. There's a good separation of the Hilbert spaces. Now, this here for the picture, I assume that these are the degrees of freedom, so it's not a lattice gauge theory. Yeah, just a scalar field, say, which you can discretize in this way. Yeah, if you do a gauge field and it's on the link and then some other, then that's precisely why for gauge theories, defining entanglement entropy associated to a region has extra subtleties. But for this discrete system, it's not. And now, a very rough estimate of how much entanglement there could be is that these interactions, so these things interact with each other, these interactions will probably entangle these bits. And these every interaction will basically create some entanglement. So a very rough estimate for the number of entangled pairs between the in and the outside is given by the number of links that the yellow circle crosses. In this case, this would be 8. If you make this thing larger, the number of links that this yellow thing crosses is roughly equal to the length of this yellow, is proportional to the length of this yellow thing. So a very crude estimate in this picture, so this is would be like a three-dimensional field theory where this is a constant time slice, is that the entanglement is given by the length divided by the lattice spacing, which is some UV cutoff A. That's a very crude estimate. But it's roughly the right kind of scaling. And you can see that when you take this lattice spacing to zero, that is diverges. So in a quantum field theory, you cannot define entanglement unless you put a short distance regulator in the theory. You cannot even factorize the Hilbert space unless you put a short distance regulator in the theory. You can do some things directly in the continuum theory without introducing this lattice regulator. But the things that you can do directly in the continuum theory mostly use methods of algebraic quantum field theory. And one of the conclusions of algebraic quantum field theory is really this, that this type of thing does not exist in a quantum field theory. It only exists when you regulate a theory like this. So this is roughly how you compute it. What was A? Oh, this was like the lattice spacing. A. A UV was like the lattice spacing. Yeah. That's the length of this yellow thing. So it's more generally, if you have a region A, it is the size of the boundary of A divided by the UV cutoff to the right number of dimensions. So it's because the boundary of the region is what intersects this thing. Now, it's interesting that this looks a bit holographic because it depends on the area, not on the volume. So there is a funny, there's some holographic flavor already at this level about entanglement entropy in the quantum field theory.
Like
You can do other decompositions, and it's also interesting to think about other ones, but it's hard to find a very precise decomposition. For example, suppose you have a free theory. You can, with creation operators A dagger K, like they create all the states in the theory, you could take HA to be created by all the creation operators where K is less than some scale, and B, everything above the scale. That then you're sort of separating the system in a low energy Hilbert space and a high energy Hilbert space, and you can talk about entanglement between energies. The thing that's not clear is whether this can be extended to an interacting theory. It would be really nice to extend it to an interacting theory, because on a small side note, in ADS, if you just draw some loop in the middle, this separates the inside from the outside, so this kind of looks like this bullock line is kind of a line that separates UV and IR degrees of freedom. So you might think that maybe the length of this loop has something to do with the entanglement between low and high energy degrees of freedom. So if it would make sense to do something like that, then maybe you could describe lengths of curves and other nice fun things. But it requires somehow an entanglement between high and low energy. And in a strongly coupled theory, you don't know how to do that. But it would be very interesting to do that. You can start with this and slowly turn on interactions. But you have to trust this basis still, and so it isn't clear how to extend it. But many of these kind of finite cutoff questions in ADS-CFT seem to suggest that something like this might exist, but no one knows how to define it. Yeah. But it's any decomposition is fine. Good. This trick of computing things by taking this limit, this is called the replica trick. Because what you need to do is you need to take your state row A, you need to replicate it n times, and then take the product of those n replicas, and then take the trace of that. That's why it's called the replica trick. In principle, in a quantum field theory, so let's do a simple example and try to understand a little bit how this entanglement structure works if you have a quantum field theory. So here's a 2D QFT. And I'm going to take A to be the region X larger than zero, and B is the other side. So this is the line, and the question is, in a two-dimensional quantum field theory, how much entanglement, can you be precise about the amount of entanglement between the right and the left? A surprising feature of any quantum field theory is that even if you're in the ground state of the quantum field theory, it turns out that things are very entangled. You might think that in the ground state of a theory, things should not be entangled, but in a quantum field theory, things are very entangled in the ground state. And so how do you compute this? Well, the easiest way to study this problem is to study the two-dimensional quantum field theory in the same way that we do quantum mechanics in a Schrödinger representation. That's not how we normally do quantum field theory. Normally, we do quantum field theory of creation annihilation operators. But for this question, a Schrödinger picture is the most useful thing. So in quantum mechanics, we have wave functions psi of q, with q is some coordinate. Right? So the phase space consists of p and q, and the wave functions are given by psi of q. They depend on the coordinates, not on the momenta. In a quantum field theory, in a two-dimensional quantum field theory, say, think of a scalar field, there's also a phase space, but it consists of, say, the values of the field at time equals zero and the values of the momenta at time equals zero. But these are still functions of one coordinate. But you can literally do the same thing as you do for quantum mechanics and look for wave functions that depend on phi of x. That's the direct generalization of the Schrödinger formalism to a quantum field theory. We almost never do this, but it can be done. And for this question, this is a nice way to think about the theory. Another thing that you can do in quantum mechanics is, in any theory, we know that, for example, QI, QF is the integral from QF to QI of E to the IS over H bar, right? This is how we always derive the relation between the Feynman path integral and quantum mechanics. If you want to compute the overlap of something, say, with the ground state, then one nice way to do it is to wick rotate this to Euclidean signature and to let the thing go all the way to minus infinity. Because now this thing will project onto the ground state. Because it's like a zero temperature limit because you go to minus infinity. One nice way to write down a representation of the overlap of a position eigenstate with the ground state is to do this half infinite Euclidean integral. So this is t equals minus infinity to qf and t equals zero. This is a nice way to make the ground state using a Euclidean preparation. And this is also a representation of the wave function, right? Because the wave function of the ground state, by definition, is this inner product. If we repeat the same sentences that we do in quantum mechanics here, then you can also compute this. So this for the ground state, so this would be the overlap of the vacuum of the theory with phi of x. This is now the thing that generalizes Q, right? It's phi of x. The way you do this is by doing some sort of Euclidean integral like this, but rather than just running over time, it also runs over space. So what you do is you take the following computation. You put on this line, you put a boundary condition phi is phi x, and then you do a path integral over the bottom half of the plane of in Euclidean signature. And if you do this path integral in Euclidean signature on half of Euclidean spacetime with this boundary condition, then you're computing the Schrödinger wave function representation of the ground state in quantum field theory. It's really a weird thing to do. And we very often don't take this Schrödinger wave function point of view. In quantum gravity, it's sometimes done when we talk about so-called Wheeler de Witt wave functions of the universe and so on. Then we're literally trying to make a Schrödinger representation of the wave function of the universe. So this is how you compute this overlap. This is how you compute the wave function. So this path integral, E minus S Euclidean, on this bottom space with this boundary condition is equal to psi naught of phi of x. Now suppose we want to decompose this space into two halves. Now I have a clear separation because here I have phi right of x and here I have phi left of x. And now the wave functions on the right are phi right of x and the wave functions on the left are phi left of x. So this is how you separate the Hilbert space in two half semi-infinite lines. So this wave function, the joint wave function, is given by doing this integral. So this is the overlap of phi left x, phi right x with the ground state. That's this computation. It's the wave function in this basis. Now you can do a simple trick that is really simple and universal, is to, rather than doing the computation in this way, we're going to do the computation in a different way. Namely, you're going to draw some lines like this, and you're going to do the computation in this way. That's just a different way to slice up the bottom half of the plane. Rather than using sort of standard time slices, we're going to do it in this way. Now, this thing here is just the rotation generator on the Euclidean plane. And if you go from here to here, we make a pi rotation. So this here, from this computation, is really the same as starting with phi left of x and doing a minus pi rotation on phi right of x. Okay? So instead of doing the computation like so, we now start here and we do a rotation and then we end up here. It's just a different interpretation of exactly the same computation. There's a little subtlety here. I have to phi right on the left. I moved it to the right. If you want to be precise, you should put a CPT operator here because we moved something from the left to the right. But that's not so important for what I want to say. Yeah, so this is how we think about this. And so we see that the ground state wave function is something where phi left of x and phi right of x not very independent from each other. They are super dependent because they're related by this e minus pi k operator here. I'll wrap up. Yeah. So this k operator, it acts on both phi left and phi right. Suppose we make an energy decomposition. So suppose we find the basis of eigenstates. Then there will be similar similar decomposition because it's kind of a symmetric situation, E left N. Suppose that you make some decomposition like this. Then what this shows you is that this whole thing can now be written as a sum over N of E to the minus pi E N Well, if you want to view this as this matrix element, then you have these inner products. But what you can, let me rewrite it slightly. What you read from this is that the ground state in this decomposition It must be equal to this, because if I take the inner product of this ground state with phi left and phi right, I pick out these structures here, and you can see it agrees precisely with this inner product here. So from this very simple cartoon representation in the Schrödinger representation, you can see that the ground state of a quantum field theory in flat space has an entangled structure of this type between particular wave functions on the left and particular wave functions on the right with something that looks like this with some energies here. And this beta here is pi in this language. Now, what's the interpretation of this statement? The interpretation of all of this, to interpret is slightly more, and that will be the last thing that I say. We need to understand what this k is. K is Euclidean rotations. So it's Euclidean time ddx minus x dd Euclidean time, something like that. It's just some standard rotation generator. If you ask what this thing does in Lorentzian signature, so let's replace the TE by E times T. If you wick rotate the two Lorentzian signature, we get this generator. This is a Lorentz boost. So a Euclidean rotation is roughly the same as a Lorentzian boost. So what these energies are, they are the energies under a Lorentz boost. Now, how does a Lorentz boost act? If this is your two-dimensional plane, a Lorentz boost acts like this. So what we have really done here is we have shown, so this is, let's call this K, the boost generator. What we really have shown is that the ground state of any two-dimensional quantum field theory is highly entangled and with factors that are given by the eigenvalues and the boost generator. And this boost generator, we can actually interpret it as a Hamiltonian if we change coordinates here into something called Rindler coordinates. Because this is an example of what's known as Rindler space. So these are also known as Rindler energies. I'll say a bit more about that later. But this fundamental decomposition shows you that the ground state is highly entangled in a very specific way, with very specific factors relating boost energy eigenstates on the right to boost energy eigenstates on the left. And this little computation underlies a large number of discussions of black hole horizons. Because a black hole horizon locally looks exactly like this. If you want the black hole horizon to be an empty place, it should behave like the ground state of a field theory locally. But that means that whatever sits on the outside of the horizon has to be very precisely entangled with whatever sits on the inside of the horizon. Otherwise, it's not the empty place that you want it to be. So many information theoretic puzzles have to do with the question how the world arranges itself to generate precisely this type of entangled structure near a black hole horizon to make sure that at the horizon nothing special is happening. And, yep. Well, the idea is that up to maybe an issue with exactly one point or so, but that can be ignored for all practical purposes, that this is a complete basis of the states on the right and a complete basis of the states on the left. And the full Hilbert space is the tensor product of both. There was no time here. I was simply asking a question about a particular state in the Hilbert space. So I'm not asking about time evolution. I'm simply saying that the ground state of the theory has this representation. And now you could time involve the left and time involve the right, that's fine, but this is just an equality of states. That's the only statement that this is. So there's no dynamics. It's purely a statement that the ground state has this very fine-tuned entangled structure in any 2D theory. And the same argument applies also in higher dimensions. You can for free add some other dimensions that really sit there as a spectator, that really don't do anything. So exactly the same argument can be made in higher dimensions as well. That choice I made in order to rewrite this equation in this entangled form. I made this choice to be able to rewrite this a bit. But this is what I derived, but to rewrite it in a nice way, I made this choice and that came out in this way. Well, you can by sort of sending x to minus x, you can see that these states can be mapped into each other one to one. So the spectrum on the left and the right is identical. Yep. Sorry, Yeah, it's not really important. If you want to be very precise, the best thing to do would to maybe, you know, you could, if you want to be very precise, you should presumably put some boundary condition here and some over boundary conditions here. So the field phi exactly at the origin, that is something that's not really captured and that you sort of need to add separately to the discussion if you wanted to do this precisely. Or you have to cut out a little, very small little window here that is more precise and put little boundary conditions there. That's the more precise way to do it if you want to. There's a different way to do this computation that doesn't require, doesn't use any of this. It uses just some algebraic quantum field theory mumbo jumbo, and then there is no issue with this point and nothing. It's all fine.
Any more questions for Jan after this beautiful lecture?
Sorry?
Bifurcation point K.
Yeah.
In on the one side of the bifurcation point, it acts in upward direction, and on the other side, it's acting downward direction.
Yeah, this is just how this Lorentz boost acts. It always this is an isometry of two-dimensional. If you do both up, that's not a symmetry of Minkowski space. You have to go one up and one down. That's an isometry.
Okay. Thank you.
So what you've done is to relate the vacuum state of an observer that's only time translating to that has a access to all space, and you relate it to the state that an observer that is constantly accelerating, since you related this Lorentz translation, this Lorentz as a time translating generator for this observer that moves in the hyperbole. Only has access to the right wedge of the space-time. So you just...
You're asking whether there is a connection between this acceleration and radiation? Very good question. So if you take an accelerated observer, you follow precisely, you're basically following a boost by K, right? That's an accelerated observer. An accelerated observer that follows such a world line has no access to this region of space-time. It's causally disconnected from it. So if you wanted to find the effective description of this observer that's being accelerated, we should take this ground state, but we should, just like I wrote at the beginning, we should look at the reduced density matrix for the A system, because that captures all the physics here. Now, if this is your state, and you compute the reduced density matrix for the A system, in this language, you will get that reduced density matrix is simply this. That is the reduced density matrix purely. So an accelerated observer sees the vacuum as this. Now, this is interesting because this doesn't look like a vacuum state. This is a thermal state with a temperature of 1 over 2 pi. So another conclusion from this computation is that an accelerated observer sees a temperature of 1 over 2 pi in these units. And this is the so-called Unruh effect. The Unruh effect basically follows from this computation as well.
Thank you.
One more question, or we thank Jan. Thanks very much.